Yo guys, so I've been using Neovim for about a year now, and today I just want to walk you through some of my Neovim setups, and I'll show you some of my favorite plugins and the plugins that I feel like I actually really like and I'm still using it till today. I'm not trying to brag or anything, but I'm just happy with how it's set up. For the terminal emulator, I'm going to be using Westerm. Before Westerm, I was actually using Alacrity, but I decided to try out Westerm instead because Westerm is like built on Rust and it seems to be a little bit more powerful than Alacrity. It has cross-platform functionality and also more GPU accelerated. The configurations file for Westerm is also written in Lua, so I think that's just a better idea to, you know, have the same thing configured in Lua because Neovim also uses Lua as its configuration language, so I would prefer things to be the same way. Before this, my Westerm was feeling a little bit clunky, but I just realized after setting the max FPS setting to at least 120, because usually it's just set by default to 75 and that's just a bit clunky, but setting it to 120 just makes it feel really fast. So yeah, this is pretty much my Westerm config. The other thing I want to talk about is the color schemes. The basic color schemes is going to be rose pine, but the cursor and border and all that foreground color is going to be my own custom colors, and the background is also going to be my own custom color. Like currently it's pure black, but right now you can't see it because I kind of have the transparency mode on, and this will also translate into Neovim. Also, if you guys don't know, I use Tmux as well, and I have it all set up right here in my Tmux configuration, and we don't need to really dive into that. So anyways, let's get started by looking at the file structures. So inside my root directory, I'm going to have a directory called Lua and then an init.lua file, of course. And in here is going to be the one calling the core and the lazy setup and also the current theme, which I will explain to you later. And in the Lua directory, I'm going to have the Sethi directory, and in here is where my core, plugins, and the lazy config lies. Inside the core, we're going to have the keymaps and options, and init.lua file is going to be the one requiring that. And in the plugins, we are going to have an LSB folder also laid inside here. And now the lazy.lua is going to be the one calling the plugins and also the LSB inside the plugins folder. So that is pretty much my file structure. Let's talk a little bit about my keymaps and options. These are just going to be personal preferences, but I've really collected some good ones in here. Things like move line up and down, that is my favorite one. Being able to just, you know, press the greater than to move it out and then lesser than to move it back in. And also leader D to delete, but will not copy it to clipboard. Like for example, if I just do this and go leader D and you check my clipboard, I actually don't have like the latest one that I just deleted. And also I have the control C as an escape key because I really don't like reaching up to the escape key because I'm that type of guy who goes like leader PF and then like control C to just leave out of it. If you're using Tmux, I have this control F where you could just instantly switch Tmux session or just create a new Tmux session within Neovim so you don't have to go out of it. If I don't have this keybind set, I need to go to a new window in my terminal and then I need to do Tmux new session and then like let's do a second session and do like that. Man, there's gonna be problems like this because we're inside Tmux, right? And it won't allow us to do that. So then I'm gonna have to do Tmux detach to get out of Tmux and then do Tmux new session to create the second session. But because inside my Neovim, I have that keybind set, I no longer have to go out of Neovim just to switch my Tmux session. So what I can actually do with this is basically just create a new Tmux session from here by just doing Control F. So for example, maybe I want to do this coding session. We have that new Tmux session. So we can go ahead and check by doing prefix Control B and then S, and then you can see that I have that new coding session again. And then I can just switch back to the first one that I was in by doing that and then going to the first one. And it has things like the tab new, tab open, tab close settings, which I don't use by the way, because I don't use tabs, but it's just there just in case. There's also split management, which I don't really use that much at all. So yeah, just in case again. We have the control D to move up and down, because every time you move up and down, you move like 10 to 20 lines, but your cursor is still in the center. So a very quick way to move through, you know, your buffer or your file. I have these two set up. Let's say I want to search for the word ops, right? And I go ops. Press enter. Now I can just press N to find and then capital N to go back through that. And that is going to be my key maps. Now let's talk a little bit about options. This is going to be personal preference. Everyone's going to have this set up differently. So you don't have to do the exact same thing that I did, but I used tab as 4. I do not have wrap on. That's one of the main things. And I use relative line number as well. That's really important for me because sometimes I go like 11J, 22J, and that just jumps me like 10 to 20 lines where I want to go. I have highlight on search as false. That is pretty much all my core settings in the key maps and options. Now, I think we should go ahead and talk about the plugins. Okay, the first one I want to talk about is Harpoon. I think you guys know what Harpoon is. It's basically a file switcher. So if I go Control E, this is basically the UI for a Harpoon. To add anything to a Harpoon list, well, let's say this is the Harpoon list, right? And I just delete the LSP configurations by doing Shift D and save it. Now, if I go to Harpoon list again, I only have two things. So to add something to a Harpoon list, I can pretty much just do LSP config again, go back here and leader A. Now, this file is being added into the Harpoon list. So there it is on the last one. So right now I have three files added in here, and I can just switch to any one of these by pressing up the Harpoon menu and pressing enter on them, and I can go back to Harpoon. I mean, if you have keybinds set for Harpoon, you could just press those keybinds and jump around those files very easily. You know, the simple, quick things that you do really does make a difference. Like, it uses less brain space somehow. And my brain doesn't have that big of a space. So I think this is just a very good thing. And I refuse to code if there's no Harpoon. Like, if there's no Harpoon available, I will not code. No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, you know what I mean, right? Like, it's that good. Like, I'm so used to it that I don't even use tabs anymore. So it's just one of those things. Envim Surround is also really, really good. For example, if I have a simple word here called random, and I just want to surround this word with like a bracket, so I can just do YSIW, and you'll notice that it just selects the whole word and you just press bracket, and it'll just surround the whole thing with a bracket. Now, if I just want to delete everything, so I just want to delete the brackets, I can just do DS brackets. And this works with every single thing. So for surrounding the words, you just have to do YSIW and just type whatever you want at the end. This works for HTML tags as well. So YSIW and then T will just give you a input to enter HTML tag. So if I do div and press enter, then I get that div. Now, if I want to change the HTML tags, then I can just do CST and I can just type the new tags inside of it. Now, to delete, well, simple enough, you can just do DST. If you actually go and find the plugin called Mini Surround, they also do the same thing, but the keybinds are just a little bit different from this. Also, there's one more thing I want to talk about, which is the HTML tags. If you do a lot of front-end work, you're going to have to write a lot of HTML tags. Like, you can imagine trying to press 5 key just to get that tag in, YSIWT. So what I actually have set up is an emit plugin. So it's Envim Emit. So the key map is leader XE, and this is just gonna wrap the word with an HTML tag. This will only work in a HTML file. So if I go ahead and show you right now, let's say I have a word called random again, and I just wanna wrap this thing in a HTML tag. I can just do leader XE, div, enter, and there you go. We have the tag. Now, combining this leader XE for wrapping the abbreviation, you combine that with Envim Surround, so D, sorry, so DST will just delete it. Also, I want to note that to set this Envim Emmet up, you need to actually set this in your LSP, which I think it's here in Mason. Yeah, it's this part of the code that you need to set up. Yeah, and they have this available on their GitHub, like in the GitHub page of the image language server. Okay, so the next one, you might have saw it coming, but obviously Telescope has got to be in this, right? Telescope is basically like a fuzzy finder. So what I have set up is leader PF. So leader PF will just allow me to search through every single file that I have in this directory. Maybe which key? Boom, I'm there at which key. If I want to go back to Telescope, leader PF, Telescope, there you go. There are things like searching for word, which is actually my favorite thing to do. Because sometimes you're like, yo, I don't remember what is the file name that I was working on. And there's like so many of them. And you're just like, wait, I kind of remember the variable name. So I'm like, okay, leader PS. What was that thing called again? Emmet something? And you'll notice that I have a preview on the right side as well that like helps me see what I'm looking at. And you can see there's files like mason.lua file that has a bunch of Emmet words in it. And there's also an Emmet.lua file. And you're like, oh, wait a minute. Oh, yeah, that's what I was looking for. I can't tell you how many times I've used the leader PS because I don't remember the file names. So yeah, because I don't use the file tree and I solely rely on Telescope and Harpoon, like imagine having to search for word in VS Code. From what I remember, you have to go to like a menu bar and like filter, I don't know, like I don't even want to talk about that. Okay, yeah, so that's one of the use case for telescope, right? And then we also have another use case. For example, let's say my cursor is right under this word config, right? I can search for the word config in my whole file. So leader PC will do that. And it just finds every single file that has the word config in it. That is a really good use case. I also have telescopes set up for my themes selection. So if I go leader TH, I don't really have many themes on my system, but if I change back to Rose Pine right now, I'm actually in Rose Pine. And also, it is persistent, meaning if I actually close Neovim right now, well, here we go again. Oh god, oh god, oh god. The Q bang, yeah, hit them with the Q bang and open Neovim again. And you'll actually see that I'm actually in Rose Pine now. So yeah, leader TH back to Groovebox. Yeah, that looks better. All right, the only reason the themes are staying persistent is because of this plugin that I'm using, which is the telescope themes. So you basically set that up. So basically, every time you change a theme right here, if I change to Rose Pine right now, you'll see that it changes to Rose Pine. The file that I was talking about earlier, which is like the current theme which I required over here, is going to run this file right here inside the Lua, which is called currentTheme.lua. So you can see that it is now in Rose Pine. But if I go ahead and quit Neovim and open it back up, you'll see that it's still in Rose Pine because this file gets updated every single time a new theme is changed using Telescope. So if I go back to Groovebox again and I quit Neovim and I come back inside, you'll see that it's Groovebox and the theme has been changed to Groovebox as well. So that's what this file is for. So inside my color scheme.lua, this is where I put all my themes, and you can see like for Rose Pine, I have all these colors set. These are just default ones. I have this thing called disable background equals true, but for other themes, it's going to be different because they're made by different people. Like for Groovebox, transparent mode equals true. And for Tokyo Night, it's low, cool, transparent, true. So basically a transparent variable down here being used and then using in all of those other color settings. And this is how the switching theme works, because I was able to set all the disabled background to true on all of these themes. Okay, so in terms of file navigation, lately I've just been using oil. It's exactly like netrw, where you just have this directory and you can go and simply just create something.lua. And if you save it, they'll ask you if you want to create it. So if not, you can just press no and you can go ahead and delete it, things like that. You can also create a directory doing like dir and then slash, and that will just make a directory, save it, and they'll just ask you again for that prompt. So yeah, it's very simple with oil, and I really like that simplicity. But if you're starting out with NeoVim and you find it a bit confusing because it doesn't have this file tree like you're used to, then I mean, nvim tree is a really good idea. For me, I don't actually use this anymore. I have this just in case I want to look at a project structure, like in case the project is like really big and I just want to look at the file structures a little bit. I can just go leader EE to bring that file structure up a little bit to look at it. But whenever you're in a really big project, you rarely use, you know, file tree to switch between files. Like, there's no way. For those big projects, I'd rather use telescope. You can press A to just create a file. Let's say I create a random file here, right? Like random.lua. And I just want to move this file out of the LSP folder. Like, you have to do things like M to mark it first and then BMV to move it. Let's say I want to move it to plugins, right? So there you go. And there you go. It's being moved to plugins. I don't even know where it is right now. But yeah, you can see the complication to that, right? Like, but for oil, if you want to like move a file, okay, for example, in here, right, I have a directory called dir. I just want to move password.js into the dir directory. What I can actually just do is shift D to delete it. And if you know in Vim, when you delete something, it pretty much copies it as well. So if I just paste it, it's the same thing, right? So if I go into dir, paste that, and you'll see that password.js is now inside the dir directory. Done. That's it. Password is being moved inside dir. Okay, there's also another one that I really want to talk about, and it's actually Git Worktree. If you don't know what Git Worktree is, I'm not gonna explain it to you. I'm sorry, but like, how Git Worktree works is incredible, and being able to use that inside NeoVim is even better. So I can basically do leader WL, and that will just allow me to switch between different work trees. I can also do leader WC, and this will allow me to create a new different work tree. For example, you want to create a feature work tree and work on that feature branch, then you can do that right here. Okay, now another one I want to talk about is the hi pattern. This plugin pretty much allows you to create like a tag of highlights in your code. Like, I could just go here, maybe write some comment, right, and be like to do like that, blah blah blah, and it's going to highlight as that color, right? I could do things like hack or maybe fix me. It's going to be red. Also, you can link this with telescope. So, but let me just go ahead and save this file real quick. So now if I go leader PT, you'll see all the tags and highlights I have in my code. So it's also one way of, you know, debugging and fixing your code. Auto pairs is also really great. I mean, it automatically does like the VS Code thing for you where it just fills in your brackets. But sometimes I find myself just typing and then it accidentally gives me another pair of brackets and I have to go back and delete. So like if you don't know how to type, maybe auto pairs is good for you. I'm not trying to be rude, but if you know how to type, I think auto pairs is just going to get in the way of you typing properly. But if you're already really used to auto pairs, there's nothing wrong with using it. You know, I still have this on, so who knows, I might just turn it off one day. Other things like get stuff where you can make like fugitive, get status. This is what fugitive allow you to do, right? So you could check your status and you have this get signs that I have set up. Now in terms of formatting and all those kind of stuff, I have it set up. I have conform set up. For example, if this code right here is not like formatted, right? Like if it's like this, like I don't have format on save turned on. I have it disabled because I don't really like it, or, you know, personal reasons. You know, don't roast me on that. But yeah, I have it set up. So if I do leader MP and it'll just auto format the whole file for me. There are also things like tailwind tools for like tailwind color setup. So like for example, if you have a tailwind color setup, then it will actually show up as the tailwind color right on top of the text, like a background, right? So that is some tailwind tools. LazyGit is also really nice. Fugitive can also do the same thing as LazyGit, but I just kind of like LazyGit a little bit better. So I could just do leader LG and it will just give me this UI. And space will pretty much just stage it. Space again to unstage it. If you want to just stage everything, you just do A or just unstage each. It's just really simple. And if you want to push something, you got to come down to this third section and just capital P to push something. Both one is just for like the commit logs and all the things that you've pushed to your remote. Question mark will just give you all the git commands that they have available. Yeah, another really nice git integration. Undo tree, another really good plugin that I really like. At first, I didn't think I was going to be able to, you know, understand why I would need an undo tree. But once you actually have that set up in your system and you actually use it, you're like, okay, that makes sense. So I have this set to leader U. If I just do leader U, it's going to give me this timeline on the left where I can just walk through all the changes and save that I've done for this file. It's really useful sometimes when you actually want to go back to the changes you made like a month ago or something like that, just to redo something or fix something. Undo tree just makes that so easy. So that is going to sum up everything I have for you guys in my Neovim setup video. And also, thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you guys enjoy this and don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe, by the way. It's just right down there. I'll link my .files repo down below in the description so you guys can go check it out if you want to. And also, I really appreciate the support on the latest video that I made like a month ago. I'll have a link it right up here and I'll see you guys in the next one.